fifth episode of our bonus series, the BPD Bunch Brunch, where we get together with our favorite brunchy beverages to catch up, play games, and talk about all things BPD. I'm your host, Xannie, and today I am here with Mo, Georgette, Jay, Céline, and Andrea. How's everybody doing today?
Excellent.
Good.
What's your brunchy beverage of choice? I have my alcohol-free Bloody Mary mixer.
I have a coffee, and my cup says stroppy without coffee. Stroppy without coffee.
Love that.
Coffee. Just coffee.
Coffee in my death cup.
And yeah, I'm a rebel, and I'm drinking green tea.
I just have water.
So for our main episode, we talked about the symptom of impulsivity, you know, sort of what it was like to experience that symptom and how we manage it. And so on our brunch episode, we are going to share some of our specific impulsivity stories and then look at those stories from a recovery lens. And if we could go back in time, how we might deal with those types of situations differently. So my impulsivity story is I was in a on-again, off-again relationship. During one of our off phases, I had to go to an appointment. And if you're really upset, driving is maybe not the best idea. So I'm like in the car driving to this appointment, like tears streaming down my face. And I take a 40 mile an hour corner at 80 miles an hour. And I start veering into the lane of oncoming traffic. And there was somebody coming. And so to avoid head-on collision, I swerved and slammed into the guardrail. All the airbags went off. I totaled my car. I'm very fortunate to be alive, actually. It's funny, a lot of people in hindsight think that that was like an intentional attempt to end my life, but it was really just reckless, impulsive, like, I don't know what I was thinking. I guess it was like, if I just drive fast enough, maybe I'll leave my emotions behind me or something like that. But oh my gosh. Yeah, if only, right? Even now in recovery, I think it's important to recognize that sometimes we get to what we would call like a skills breakdown point where you're not really able to totally overcome the moment and behave in a functional way. So either I would just cancel the appointment, or, you know, if there was somebody who was willing to drive that far, like ask for a ride, that's what I would do differently.
I also relate to mood relating to driving. I think what music you listen to in the car will affect my mood. If I get in the car and I'm angry and I listen to worship music, I always feel calmer afterwards. Whereas if I listen to something that's gonna rile me up, I'm gonna stay in that mood longer. So the driving is one thing, it's an outlet, right? But it's also in terms of impulsivity, I think there are ways we can adapt the outlet, the reckless outlet or the impulsive outlet, even if you still have to do it. But I can definitely relate to the driving. I quite like to drive fast even when I'm in a good mood. So, but I think
fantastic, isn't it?
Exactly. So for me, back when I was not in recovery, I was a huge drinker. One of my more dangerous moments was when I went with a group of people. We walked to a club and I decide to leave without telling anyone. I just left because I was like mad or depressed or something. So I'm walking alone at nighttime. I remember like people honking at me. So I must have been like obviously drunk, you know? And so I remember I was about halfway through my walk and this car, some guy like shouted something to me. And I think he was trying to be helpful, but I ended up like flipping him off. And he said, okay, have fun getting raped. And I was like, and that was like a sobering moment for me. And then I realized, like, I still was drunk, of course, but I realized like, this is not good. You know, that was like one of those moments when I'm like, yeah, maybe I should stop drinking. The impulsive part was, you know, I don't even remember what upset me at the club, but I got really depressed. And instead of just like either staying at the club or at least like telling my friends that I was leaving, I decided to just leave and not tell anyone. And, you know, I'm sure I wasn't safe about walking. Like I would just cross the street, couldn't care less if a car was coming. And, you know, looking back, first of all, I wouldn't have had that much to drink, you know, that's number one. But number two is, even if I had gotten drunk, I could have been so much safer about it. I could have asked a friend to come with me, or, you know, asked someone to pick me up. I was young. I had plenty of friends who were out and about at 12, 1 a.m.
I have a really similar story, though. Like, there's a week here in San Antonio, and it's called Fiesta, and it's a full week of people just getting trashed downtown. Anyway, so I just remember, like, looking at these people, and I was like, I only know you and you. I don't know any of y'all, and I don't want to be around any of y'all. I'm leaving. So here I am, super drunk, like, walking downtown. I don't even think I knew in my right mind, like, where I was going. But, like, I just left, wandered off. I think everybody's got, like, a drunk story. I'm leaving my group. Bye. And just going. Mm-hmm.
Listening to both you, Andrea and Yumo, is that I kind of observe almost, like, two separate points of impulsivity. There's, like, the initial impulsive choice maybe to, like, drink in a setting or situation where maybe there's not enough foresight. And then, on top of it, there's the impulsivity that comes as a result of the inhibited judgment from the substance. It's sort of like a compounded moment there, yeah. In a way.
I think drawing on that point, I kind of wanted to identify the theme of when we're in recovery and how we may have dealt with that differently. It seems to be about making sure we're safer. Like you said, Xannie, like, I would make a plan, or Mo, you were like, I wouldn't drink as much. One or two drinks is okay. It's like, it's not that I'm going to completely avoid the party or the drinking, wherever it happens to be. It's that, how can I be safer in this, knowing that I have a propensity to be impulsive or reckless? When we were planning this session, I was thinking, when have I been impulsive? When have I been reckless? What can I talk about, and what would I do differently? And there's a number of situations where I was impulsive and maybe reckless, but wouldn't change a thing, like getting my tattoo. I went to a recognized place that I knew that I was safe, that they were clean, and I got the tattoo that I wanted and I loved it. There's no regret there. There was no danger.
There's one really important distinction to make between, like, impulsivity as a symptom of BPD versus, like, being spontaneous, is that, like, the impulsivity in BPD specifically has this, like, danger element. It's the stuff where we're maybe not really thinking about the consequences or doing things that are either physically or emotionally damaging to us or others. But, you know, like, we have a lot of cool adventures, too, yeah, as a result of our impulsivity, right? Like, I just think that's important to say, like, it's not all bad.
The biggest impulsive thing I did. So I met this girl online. So she was going to a music festival, and I was going to the same music festival, and we had been kind of flirty online for about 3 months. So we met up a few weeks later. She was like, hey, why don't you come visit me in Houston? I'm getting a divorce and my husband moved out. And I was like, that sounds reasonable. So I drove, spent the weekend, and I was leaving to drive back. And I thought, nah, I'm just going to stay here for another, I don't know, indefinite. So I turned around, went back and knocked on the door. And she was like, very delighted that I decided to come back, and that's how I moved to Houston for almost a year.
Oh, wow.
Wow!
Would I do that again now? No.
Jay, you said you turned around and went back to her place. Like, did you do it, like, because you thought there was going to be, like, this long-term serious relationship?
I thought I was.
Like, did you think you were being romantic, or?
I thought I was being incredibly romantic, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. Because, okay. You know,
when you were telling that story, I was thinking, like, wow, that's, like, a great example of extreme impulsivity.
Oh, oh yeah.
But also, like, I think that's one of the things that differentiates we who suffer from this from people who are like, I'm just a spontaneous person. Like, you in a second decided to go back to somebody and to hell with the consequences.
Yep. And there were many. So that's true. Like, everything. Yeah, it's that's just what BPD is in a nutshell. It's just everything's turned up to 11. All right, who's next?
So the one that I wanted to talk about was how I reacted when our boyfriend ended the relationship with me. There was another guy who was interested in me, and I wasn't interested in him like that, but he was really trying it on before my boyfriend broke up with me. So I knew he was there on the scene. I knew he liked me and I wasn't interested. But the moment that my boyfriend at the time ended it, he did it by text, rolling my eyes. Ooh. Yeah. And I was sitting at home watching TV with my dad and I got this text and I was just like, I didn't even cry. I looked at the text and I was like, Dad, I'm going out. And I got in my car and I drove straight to that other guy. I didn't even tell him my boyfriend had broken up with me. And I just like walked into his bedroom and we just had sex and he thought I was cheating on my boyfriend. And afterwards he was like, I feel really shit about that. And I was like, oh, by the way, he broke up with me. I was like, didn't want to tell you because didn't want you to think you're a rebound. But obviously he was. He was so obvious. And it's just, and then we continued kind of hooking up with friends with benefits for a while, but I led him on because I wasn't interested. And if I'd gone back and I did it now, I wouldn't have messed around with his feelings. I would have taken the time to feel the emotions I was running away from. If I wanted a distraction, I could have done that without hurting someone else in the long run. So that's something that I think is quite a good example of where I wasn't in any danger. So that wasn't a dangerous act, but it was impulsive and it led to consequences later on that where I'd hurt someone else's feelings who was interested in me and he knew he was a rebound. And then I didn't want to go out with him afterwards and it really hurt him. And I was just using him and I feel really bad about that because that's not the kind of person I want to be.
He wasn't a rebound. He was just a bound. That sounds weird, but I mean, I've been there. It wasn't like, oh, you're a rebound. You're gonna, you know, you're whatever. It's not even that deep.
You don't even think that far ahead.
Yeah, you don't even think that far ahead. Yeah. You're just like, I feel bad in the moment, and you know what's gonna make me feel great? This person actually wants me. So let's go ahead and do that.
Yeah, well, I can piggyback off of your story. I don't even have one specific story because they all go together. It meshes into, this is the story. I would have a negative feeling, like feeling lonely or sad or upset. And because I couldn't tolerate it, I would go on Tinder. I would meet somebody, I would reach out to someone without thought to consequences, without thought to anything. It would just be like, I need to go out. I'm going to meet somebody right now. Whatever happens, happens. Meeting people, not practicing safe sex, you know, because I'm in the moment, or meeting people that weren't the best idea to meet, that where I maybe didn't feel as safe. Anything to run away and not have to sit with the feelings I had. I just wanted to feel better in that very moment. When I sought out things in like a sexual or relationship kind of way, it was feeling like I was worth something and that somebody wanted me. And that gave me this sense of like, okay, I feel like a person now. So that was how I would deal with things before. That impulsivity is still there. And I think that the way I've been able to manage it now in recovery is, one, learning how to sit with the level of distress and with those distressing feelings. And then I've kind of toned it down. So like if I'm feeling impulsive and I'm still getting that feeling and wanting to do those sorts of things, I have come up with like safer alternatives. So I have a, you know, photos that I'll take a sexy photo, but I do not send it to people. I've learned to call family, to call friends, to reach out and find that sense of connection in a way that isn't so damaging. And I'm not saying that going out and like one night stands and impulsively seeing people or even like impulsively having sex with somebody is necessarily a negative thing. But I think that in the long run, it wasn't serving me. You know, there are some situations that I ended up in that were really unsafe.
what you were mentioning about some of those behaviors not necessarily being a problem. That a lot of the what makes something a reckless, impulsive decision is doing things to avoid emotion rather than because they align with your values, right? Like,
right.
Personally, when I engaged in a lot of that behavior, it was specifically to not deal with emotions or whatever. And when I really thought about my values, like, I'd always envisioned myself being with one person forever and having a committed, loving relationship. And yet I was not acting in line with what I wanted for myself. Another thing you brought up was the adjusting to different behaviors. Sometimes I still feel the need to kind of act out in a way, but mm-hmm. I've found other ways to kind of do that. I'll just stay up a few hours later than I know I really should, you know, like give in to some of those impulsive things, knowing that they're not going to have the best consequences, but it's not the same as like going out and getting trashed and waking up someplace I don't recognize without any pants, which has also happened before.
I really want to hear that story.
There was one time I went to a party in New York and I got blackout drunk very early in the night. And then I woke up in Queens at somebody's house without a coat, without my pants. And I had to get on the train and ride from Queens to Manhattan without any pants on.
So you never were able to, like, the only pantsless person to ever do that ride in Manhattan, though.
Yeah, I've never pieced together that story. I have no idea what happened from beginning to end.
And I think that's something that, like, that is important to recognize, like the impulsivity. You give no thought. There's no thought behind it. That's why it's impulsive, and it's usually running away from something, avoiding something, or seeking something out that you can't figure out the logical or like the safer way to do it. So you just jump out. I'm going to jump out of the airplane. I'm just going to do it. I don't think about how it's going to affect me later.
Andrea, you've been very quiet for a lot of this. You got to tell your story.
I'm actually like reflecting on a lot of the stuff y'all are saying. I'm kind of like, because I mean, I've had experiences with this subject, but like it was more in my late teens, early 20s. And my experience was like self-sabotage, and it came from a really hurt place. I was hurt by someone. I was taken advantage of. I think it was the beginning of what was should have been my senior year. So I was 17, going to be 18. And after that happened, it broke me. And I stopped caring about myself, and I didn't care who I did it with. I just, if I knew in the back of my head that that's what they wanted from me, I would just give it up so they'd leave me alone. I had a really good friend. He's actually my daughter's father. He passed away when we were 21, but he would always give me like the lowdown on boys. This is how they are. So after that situation happened to me, I kind of used that power, which is what I thought I was using. And then when I wanted to be back in a relationship with him, he just could not understand why I wouldn't sleep with him. He didn't know what happened to me. I hadn't told him. All he knew was that I was just messing up left and right. Once it came down to it, we were actually living together. We were already about 20 years old by this time. He was like, I don't understand it. You like lived these couple of years just doing whatever. Like, why won't you do it with me? And I told him why. And he was like, this explains everything. And he was like, you didn't want to be loved, you know, and you don't feel like you deserve love because something was taken from you. And after he had passed away, I didn't continue that behavior as recklessly, but it was still somewhat there. And then I was kind of like, I don't even like doing this. I just started cutting things off. And like, I started to begin like actual relationships. I still know some people in my nowadays were kind of like, I remember you. I remember how you were. And it's just like, I was a broken girl back then. Like, the reason that I was like that had nothing to do with the idea that I actually enjoyed being that way. It was just some sort of powerful sword that I thought that I had. So yeah, that's what I was kind of like thinking about whenever y'all were all talking about this. I was like, should I talk about it? It falls in the same subject, but it's not similar, you know?
I actually think this is totally relevant. I mean, because yeah. It's not like all of these impulsive behaviors just come out of nowhere, right? They're all either a response to, you know, something external or something internal. And I guess my question for you is, if you could go back in time with the things that you know now, how would you maybe deal with all of that differently?
If I could go back, I would have told somebody what happened. And the reason I didn't tell anybody what happened was because he was someone that everybody knew. And I didn't think that anybody would believe me. And at that time, there was a lot of like, and there's still some of these types of people that are out there that are like that. Like, well, why did you put yourself in that position? And then there's the shame that comes with it. So, yeah, I hadn't broken my silence about it. As far as now me being older and pretty much from 24 and on, I've just been so addicted to love and just like wanting to have like that amazing relationship with just this really intense love. Georgette, I remember you saying something about with no boundaries. Like that was something that I like yearned for because I thought that was okay.
Boundaries are good and boundaries are necessary. Yeah. I want a love with no boundaries. You really don't. You want to live. Yeah. You want you really chaos don't. Is what you want. You want to live in the middle of a shipwreck.
Andrew, I want to thank you for sharing because I can see that that was really, it was tough to share. And I think you hit on some really, really personal and painful points. And so thank you. Thank you. Yes. I don't know if I'm good at doing that, but but I want to actually say, you said something, you saw that sexual power, like a sword that you could wield. And I just want to touch on that because my ex-partner, he thought I was like a sexual dynamo. And it wasn't until I was in recovery from this that I could verbalize and say like, no, what you were looking at as a sword, like a power and something amazing was actually self-harm, self-hatred. Like it was, none of it was good. On the outside, it looks like one thing, like that sword and how powerful you are and look at this, but on, when you really look at it, it is pain.
Yeah.
100%.
So Andrea, I gotta tell you, I had a similar experience and the same reaction. I had not had very many sexual experiences in my life until after that. And it was like, it's kind of like, I'm going to overwrite this experience by doing it on purpose as many times as possible. And then maybe I will get my power back.
Yeah.
And so I just wanted to tell you that you're not alone in that experience. And I don't think that makes you broken. For anybody watching, I know we got kind of heavy today. So, you know, if you're feeling a little out of sorts, make sure you take a moment to take care of yourself. And hopefully the message from this is, you know, that you're not alone, that, you know, we have all been through some of the same things that you have been through. And, you know, even though we're not all like, it's not like we're fully unaffected by those things anymore, right? But we've learned to be able to live fulfilling lives despite those challenges. And that's kind of why we're here. And with that, we're going to wrap up. So thank you so much, everyone, for watching. I make sure that you like, subscribe, and turn on your notifications to figure out when we're getting the next episode. And we'll see you next time.
Bye.
Bye. Bye.